in thunder, lightning, or in rain.
When the hurly-burly's done, when the battle's lost and won,
that will be ere the set of sun.
Where the place?
Upon the heath.
There to meet with Macbeth.
I come, Grey Malkin.
Petticoats. Anon.
Fair is foul, and foul is fair. Hover through the fog, and fill the air.
Bloody man is that? He can report. That seemeth by his plight of the revolt, the newest state.
But 'tis a sergeant who, like a good and haughty soldier, fought against my captivity. Hail, brave friend. Say to the king the knowledge of the boy, lest thou didst leave it.
Doubtful it stood, as two spent swimmers that do cling together and choke their art. The merciless MacDonald. Well, he deserves that rebel's name due to the villainy swarming upon him from the western isles of Kerns and Galapasses, a supply and fortune on his damned quarrel, smiling, showed like a rebel's whore. But all's too weak for brave Macbeth. Well, he deserves that name with his brand of steel, disdaining fortune, which smote with bloody execution, till he faced the slave, carving out his passage, and ne'er shook hands, nor bade farewell to him, till he unseamed him from the nave to the chops, and hung his head upon our battlements.
Valiant cousin, worthy gentleman.
Once the sun begins his reflection, shipwrecking storms and direful thunders break. So from that spring, when comfort seemed to come, discomfort swells. Mark, King of Scotland, mark! No sooner justice had with valor on compelled these skipping kerns to shrug their heels, but the Norwegian lord surveyed vantage with furbished arms, and new supplies of men began a fresh assault.
Dismayed this not our captains, Macbeth and Banquo?
Yes, as sparrowed eagles, or the hare, the lion. If I say sooth, I must report they were as cannons overcharged with double cracks, so they doubly redoubled their strokes upon the foe. Except they meant to bathe in reeking wounds or memorize another Golgotha, I cannot tell. I am faint. My gashes cry for help.
So will thy words become me as thy wounds. They smack of honor both. Go, get your surgeons. Who comes here?
The worthy Lady Ross and Lady Angus.
What haste looks through their eyes. So shall they look that seems to speak things strange.
God save the king.
Whence camest thou, worthy ladies?
From Fife, great king, where the Norwegian banners flout the sky and fan our people cold. Norway himself, with terrible numbers, assisted by that most disloyal traitor, the Thane of Cawdor, began a dreadful conflict, till that Bellona's bridegroom, lapped in proof, confronted him with self-comparisons, point against point rebellions, arm against arm, curbing his lavish spirit, and to conclude, the victory fell on us.
Great heavens.
That now Sweno, the Norway's king, craves composition, nor would we deign him burial of his men till he dispersed it at St. Columb's Inch, $10,000 to our general use.
No more that Thane of Cawdor shall deceive our bosom interest. Go pronounce his present death, and with his former title, greet Macbeth.
We'll see it done.
What he hath lost, noble Macbeth hath won.
tiger. But in a sieve I'll thither sail, and like a rat without a tail, I'll do, and I'll do.
Of belief, no more than to be called. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence, or why upon this blasted heath you stop our way with such prophetic preaching. Speak, I charge you!
Ah.
breath into the wind, would they have stayed? What is this here that we just speak about? Or have we eaten on the insane roof that takes the reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
And Thane of Cawdor too, but did not so.
To the self same tune and word. Oh, who comes here?
The king hath happily received, Macbeth, the news of thy success. And when he reads thy personal venture in the rebels' fight, his wonders and his praises do contend which should be thine or his. Is silenced with that, and viewing o'er the rest of the selfsame day, he finds thee in the stout Norwegian ranks. Nothing afeard of what thyself didst make, strange images of death. As thick as hail came post with post, and every one did bear thy praises in his kingdom's great defense, and poured them down before him.
We are sent to give thee from our royal master thanks, only to herald thee into his sight, not to pay thee.
And for an earnest of a greater honor, he bade me from him call thee Thane of Cawdor. In which addition, hail, most worthy Thane, for it is thine.
What? The devil speak true.
The Thane of Cawdor lives. Why do you dress me in borrowed robes?
Who was the Thane lives yet, but under heavy judgment bears that life which he deserves to lose. Whether he was combined with those of Norway, or did lie in the revel with hidden help and vantage, or that with both he labored in his country's wrack, I know not, but treason's capital, confessed and proved, have overthrown him.
Not in the Thane of Cawdor. The greatest is behind. Thanks for your pains. Do you not hope that your children shall be kings when those that gave the Thane of Cawdor to me promised no less to them?
That trusted home might yet entitle you under the crown, besides the Thane of Cawdor. It is strange, and oftentimes to win us to our harm, the instruments of darkness tell us truths, win us with honest trifles, to betray us in deepest consequence. Cousins, a word, I pray.
Two truths are told as happy prologues to the swelling act of the imperial theme.
I thank you, gentle ladies. This supernatural soliciting cannot be ill, cannot be good. Ill, why hath it given me earnest of success, commencing in a truth? I am Thane of Cawdor. If good, why do I yield to that suggestion whose horrid image doth unfix my hair and make my seated heart beat at my ribs? Against the use of nature. Present fears are less than horrible imaginings.
Look how our partner's wrapped.
If chance will have me king, why chance may crown me without my stir.
New honors come upon him. Like our strange garments, cleave not to their mold, but to the aid of use.
Come what, come may, time and the hour run through the roughest day.
Worthy Macbeth, we stay upon your leisure.
Give me your feather. My dull brain was wrought with things forgotten. Let us draw the king.
Think upon what hath chanced, and in more time, the interim having waited, let us speak our free hearts each to other.
Very glad.
Till then, enough. Come, friends.
Is execution done on Cawdor? Are not those in commission yet returned?
My liege, they are not yet come back. But I have spoken with one that saw him die, who did report that very frankly he confessed his treasons, begged your highness pardon, and set forth a deep repentance. Nothing in his life became him like believing it. Died as one that had been studied in his death to throw away the dearest thing he owed as were a careless trifle.
There's no art to read the mind's construction in the face. He was a gentleman on whom I built an absolute trust.
Oh, worthiest Cawdor, the sin of my ingratitude
Even now it is heavy on me. Thou art so far before, that swiftest wing of recompense is sure to overtake thee. Only I have left to say, more is thy due, and more than all can pay.
The service and the loyalty I owe in doing it pays itself. Your Highness part is to receive our duties, and our duties are to your throne and state, servant and children, who do but what they should by doing everything safe toward your love and honor.
Welcome hither. I have begun to plant thee, and will labor to see thee full of growing. Noble Banquo, thou hast no less deserved. I must be known no less to have done so. Let me fold thee and hold thee to my heart.
There, if I grow, the harvest is your own.
My plenteous joys, wanton in fullness, seek to hide themselves in drops of sorrow. Sons, kinsmen, thanes, and those whose places are the nearest, know we shall establish our estate upon our elders, Malcolm, whom we name hereafter the Prince of Cumberland, which honor shall not unaccompanied invest him only, but signs of nobleness like stars shall shine on all deserves. From hence to Inverness, and bind us closer to you.
The rest is labor which is not used for you. I'll be myself the harbinger, and make joyful the hearing of my wife with your approach. So humbly take my leave.
On your report.
Prince of Cumberland. That is a step on which I must fall down or else o'erleap.
For in my way lies stars hide your fires. Let not light see my black and deep desires. The eye wink at the hand, yet let that be, which the eye fears when it is done to seek.
True, noble Banquo. He is both so valiant, and his commendations are a banquet to me. Let's after him, whose care has gone before to make us welcome. It is a peerless kinsman.
They met me in the day of success, and I have learned by the perfectest report they have more in them than mortal knowledge. When I burned in desire to question them further, they made themselves air into which they vanished. Whilst I stood wrapped in the wonder of it, came missives from the king, who all hailed me Thane of Cawdor. By which title before these weird sisters saluted me and referred me to the coming on of time with Hail, King, that shalt be. This have I thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mightst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness is promised thee. Lay it to thy heart and farewell. Longs thou art. And Cawdor, and shalt be what thou art promised. Yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great, art not without ambition, but without the illness should attend it. What thou wouldst highly, that wouldst thou holily, wouldst not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou'dst have, great Glamis, that which cries, thus thou must do, if thou have it, and that which rather thou dost fear to do than wishes should be undone. Oh, hie thee hither, that I may pour my spirits in thine ear, and chastise with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round, which fate and metaphysical aid seem to have thee crowned with all. What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it. Is not thy master with him?
who, were it so, would have informed for preparation.
So please you, it is true. Our thane is coming. One of his servants had the speed of him, who, almost dead for breath, had scarcely more than would make up his message.
Give him tending. He brings great news.
The raven himself is hoarse. That croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits, that tend on mortal thoughts. Unsex me here, and fill me from the crown to the toe, top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood. Stop up the access and passage to remorse, that no compunctious visitings of nature shake my fell purpose, nor keep peace between the effect and it. Come to my woman's breasts and take my milk for gall. You murdering ministers, wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief, come, thick night, and pall thee in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark to cry, hold, hold! Great lungs. Worthy Cawdor, greater than both by the all hail hereafter, thy letters have transported me beyond this ignorant present, and I feel now the future in the instant.
My dearest love. Duncan comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Oh, never shall sun that morrow see. Your face, my thane, is as a book where men may read strange matters. To beguile the time, look like the time, bear welcome with your eye, your hand, your tongue, look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent under it. He that's coming must be provided for, and you shall put this night's great business into my dispatch, which shall, to all our nights and days to come, give solely sovereign sway and masterdom.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear. To alter favor ever is to fear. Leave all the rest to me.
This castle hath a pleasant seat. The air nimbly and sweetly recommends itself unto our gentle senses.
Yes, the son of the temple haunting mortal pleasant peruse, by his loved mansion raided, heaven's breath smells wooingly here. No pithy buttress frieze or coin abandoned, this bird has built this pendant bed in appropriate cradle. Where they most haunt and breed, I've observed the air is delicate.
See our noble hostess. The love that follows us sometimes is our trouble, but still we thank. As love.
All our service, in every point twice done, and then done double, were poor and single business to contend against those honors, deep and broad, wherewith your majesty loads our house.
Where's the thane of Cawdor? We crossed him at the heels, and had a purpose to be his purveyor, but he rides well, and his great love, sharp as his spur, hath helped him to his home before us. Fair and noble hostess, we are your guests tonight.
Your servants ever have theirs, themselves, and what is theirs in compt, to make their audit at
at your highness' pleasure. Still, to return your own.
Give me your hand. Conduct me to mine host. We love him highly, and will continue our graces toward him by your leave, hostess.
If it were done, when 'tis done, then 'twere well it were done quickly. If the assassination could trammel up the consequence and catch with his surcease success, that but this blow might be the be-all and the end-all here. But here, upon this bank and shoal of time, we'd jump the life to come. But in these cases, there is still judgment here. That we but teach bloody instructions, which being taught, returns to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poisoned chalice to our own lips. He is here in double trust. First, as I am his kinsman, and his subject, strong both against the deed. Then as his host, who should, against his murderer, shut the door, not bear the knife myself. Besides, this Duncan hath born his faculties so meek, hath been so clear in his great office, that his virtues shall plead like angels, trumpet-tongued, against the deep damnation of his taking off. In pity, like a naked newborn babe, riding the blast or heaven's cherubim, horsed upon the sightless couriers of the air, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye, the tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of my intent, only vaulting ambition, which o'erleaps itself and falls on the other. How now? What news?
He has almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Hath he asked for me?
Know you not he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. He hath honored me of late, and I have bought golden opinions from all sorts of people, which would be worn in its newest gloss, not cast aside so soon.
Was the hope drunk wherein you dressed yourself? Hath it slept since, and wakes it now to look so green and pale at what it did so freely? From this time, such I account thy love. Art thou afeard to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteemest the ornament of life, and live a coward in thine own esteem, letting I dare not wait upon I would, like the poor cat in the attic.
Prithee, peace! I dare do all that may become a man. Who dares do more is none.
What beast was it then that made you break this enterprise to me? When you durst do it, then you were a man. And to be more than what you were, you would be so much more the man. No time nor place did then adhere, and yet you would make both. They have made themselves, and that their fitness now does unmake you. I have given suck, and know how tender 'tis to love the babe that milks me. I would, while it was smiling in my face,
have plucked my nipple from his boneless gums and dashed the brains out, had I so sworn, as you have done to this!
And if we should fail?
We fail? But screw your courage to the sticking place and will not fail. When Duncan is asleep, where to the rather shall his day's hard journey soundly invite him? His two chamberlains will I with wine in wassail so convince that memory, the warder of the brain, shall be a fume, and the receipt of reason a limbeck only. When in swinish sleep their drenched natures lie as in a death, had not you and I perform upon the unguarded Duncan?
What not put upon his spongy officers who shall bear the guilt of our great quell?
Bring forth men, children only, for thy undaunted metal should compose nothing but males. Will it not be received when we have marked with blood those sleepy two of his own chamber, and use their very daggers, but they have done it.
Who dares receive it other, as we shall make our griefs and clamor roar upon his death?
Settled and bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away and mark with fairest show. False face must hide. False heart doth know.
How goes the night, boy?
The moon is down. I have not heard the clock.
And she goes down at 12.
I think it is late.
Hold. Take this, my dagger. There's husbandry in heaven. Her candles are all out. Heavy summons lies like lead upon me, and yet I would not sleep. Merciful heavens, cursed be the thoughts that nature gives way to the repose. But who's here?
A friend. Huh. What, sir?
Not yet at rest. The king's a bed. He hath been in a most unusual weather, and set forth great largesse to your offices. So, this diamond he greets your wife withal. In the name of most kind hostess, all shut up in measureless content.
Being unprepared, our will became servant to defect, which else should free and wrought.
But all's well. I dreamt last night of the three-eared sisters. To you, they have shown some truth.
They think not of them. Yet, when we can entreat an hour to serve, I would spend it in some time upon that business, if you would grant the time.
At your kindest leisure.
If you would cleave to my consent, when it is, it shall make honor for you.
So I lose none in seeking to augment it, but keep my bosom franchise clear, my allegiance clear, I shall be counseled.
Good repose, the while. The like to you, sir. Go, bid thy mistress. When my drink is ready, she strike upon the bell. Get thee to bed.
Is this the dagger I see before me? Handle toward my hand. Come, let me clutch thee. See thee still. Art thou not fatal vision, subject to feeling as to sight, or art thou but a dagger of the mind, a false creation proceeding from the interpressive brain? I see thee yet, in form as palpable as this which now I draw. Thou marshalest me the way I was going, and such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes are made the fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee still. And on that vain induction, gouts of blood which was not so before. There is no such thing. It is the bloody business which informs us to my knife. Now for the one half world, nature seems dead, and wicked dreams abuse the curtained sleep. Witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offering, and withered murder, alarmed by his sentinel, the wolf, whose howls his watch. Thus, with his stealthy pace, with Tarquin's ravishing strides towards his design, moves like a ghost. Thou sure and firm center, hear not my steps which way I walk, for fear thy very stones greet my whereabout, and take the present horror from the time which now sits with it. Whiles I threat, he lives. Words to the heat of deeds, too cold breath gives. I go, and it is done. The bell invites me. Hear it not, Duncan, for it is a knell that summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which hath made them drunk hath made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire. Hark! Peace. It was the owl that shrieked, the fatal bellman, which gives the sternest good night. He is about it. The doors are open, and the sure-footed grooms do mock their charge with snores. I have drugged their possets, that death and nature do contend about them whether they live or die.
Who's there? What ho!
Alack, I am afraid they have awaked. It is not done. The attempt and not the deed confounds us. Hark! I laid their daggers ready. He could not miss him. Had he not resembled my father as he slept, I had done it. My husband!
I have done the deed.
Oh.
Didst thou not hear a noise?
I heard the owl scream and the crickets cry. Did not you speak?
When?
Now.
As I descended?
Aye.
Hark. This is a sorry sight.
A foolish thought to say a sorry sight.
This one did laugh in his sleep, and the other cried, murdered. Yet they did wake each other. I stood and heard them, but they did say their prayers and addressed them again to sleep. One cried, God bless us, and amen. The other, as they had seen me with these hangman's hands, I, listening their fear, I could not say, amen. When they did say, God bless us,
consider it not so deeply.
Wherefore could I not pronounce amen? I must need a blessing and amen stuck in my throat.
These deeds must not be thought after these ways, so it will make us mad.
If I hear the cry, Macbeth shall sleep no more. The innocent sleep. Sleep then yet suck the rattled sting of care. The death of each day's life. Balm of hurt minds. Sore labor's bath. Chief nourisher in life's feast.
What do you mean?
And still it cried, sleep no more to all the house. Gods have heard it sleep, and therefore Cawdor shall sleep no more. Macbeth shall sleep no more.
Who was it that was crying?
Best not know myself. Wait, Duncan! Even with thy lacking, I would thou couldst.
Here's a knocking indeed. If a man were a portrait of Hellgate, he should have old turning the key. Knock! 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 Who's there in the name of Beelzebub? Here's a farmer who hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Woohoo! Come in time. Have napkins and have a voucher. Here, you'll sweat for it. Knock, knock. Who's there? Faith. Here's an equivocator who could swear in both the scales against either scale, who committed treason enough, for God's sake, that could not equivocate to heaven. Woohoo!
Physics pit. This is the door.
I'll make so bold to call, for 'tis my limited service.
Goes King hence today?
He does. He did appoint so.
The night has been unruly. Where we lay, our chimneys were blown down. And, as they say, lamenting's heard in the air. Strange screams of death and prophesizing with accents terrible. Dire combustion and confused events, new hatched the woeful time. The obscure bird clamored the livelong night. Some say the earth was feverous and did shake.
'Twas a rough night.
My young remembrance cannot parallel the foe to it.
Horror, horror, horror! Tongue nor heart cannot conceive nor name me.
What's the matter?
Confusion now hath made his masterpiece. Most sacrilegious murder hath broke up the Lord's anointed temple and stolen then the life of a building. What is it you say, the life?
Mean you his majesty?
Curse the chamber. Destroy your sight with a new gorgon. Do not bid me speak. See and speak yourselves. Awake! Awake! Ring the alarm bell. Murder and treason! Banquo, Malcolm, awake!
Shake off this downy sleep, death's come of it, and look on death itself. Up, up, and see the great doom's image.
Malcolm! Banquo! As
Gentle lady, 'tis not for you to hear what I can speak. The repetition in a woman's ear would murder as it fell.
Oh, Banquo! Banquo! The royal master's murdered!
Woe, alas! What in our house?
Oh, too cruel anywhere! You doth prove to contradict thyself, and say it's not so?
Had I but died an hour before this chance, I had lived a blessed time. But from this instant, there is nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys. Renown and grace is dead. The wine of life is drawn, and the mere lees left this vault to brag of.
What is amiss?
You are, and do not know it. This spring, the source, the fountain of your blood is stopped. The very source of it is stopped.
Your royal father is murdered.
Oh.
By whom?
Those of his chamber, have done it. Their hands and faces were all badged with blood. So were their daggers, which I might lay upon their pillow. They stared and were distracted. No man's life was to be trusted with them.
Oh, yet I do repent me of my fury that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise? Mazed, temperate, and furious, loyal and neutral in a moment. No man. The expedition of my violent love outrun the pause of reason. Here, my Duncan, his silver skin laced with his golden blood, and his gashed stabs looked like a breach in nature. For ruin's wasteful entrance. There, the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could be framed that had a heart to love, and in that heart, the courage to make his love known?
Help me, Hans! Oh!
Look to the lady.
Why do we hold our tongues? At most we claim this argument for hours. It should be spoken here. When our fate hid like an Argohol, we'd run and rush and seize us. Let's away. Our tears are not yet brewed, nor our strong sorrow upon the foot of motion.
Look to the lady. When we have our naked frailties hid, we suffer an exposure. Let us meet and question this most bloody piece of work to know it further. Fears and scruples shake us. I stand in the great hand of God. Thence, against this unvolt pretense, I fight against treasonous malice.
So do I.
And so do I. Let us put on manly readiness and meet in the hall together. Well contented.
Well contented.
Well contented.
Showing unfelt sorrow is an office which the false man does easily. Out to England.
To Ireland, aye. Our separate fortune shall keep us both the safer.
Where we are, there's murder and men's smiles. The near in blood, the nearer bloody. And our safest way is to avoid the aim. Therefore, the horse. And let us not be dainty of leave-taking, but shift away. It is warrant in that theft which steals itself when there's no mercy left.
Threescore and ten, I can remember well. We within the volume of which time I have seen, hours dreadful and things strange, but this sore night hath trifled former knowings.
Oh, good lady, thou seest the heavens as troubled with man's act, threatened his bloody stage. By the clock, 'tis day, and yet dark night strangles the traveling lamp. Is it night's predominance or the day's shameless? Darkness does the face of earth entomb when living light should kiss it?
'Tis unnatural, even when the deed is done. On Tuesday last, a falcon, towering near final place, was by a mousing owl caught at and killed.
And Duncan's horses, a thing most strange and certain, beauteous and swift, the minions of their race, turned wild in nature, broke their shells, flung out, contending against obedience as they would make war with mankind.
'Tis sad, they ate each other.
They did so, to the amazement of my eyes that looked upon it. Here comes the good Macduff. How goes the world, sir, now?
See you not.
Is it known who did this more than bloody deed?
Those that Macbeth hath killed.
Last the day, what good can they pretend?
It was suborned. Malcolm Donnelly, the king's own sons, have stolen away the flame, which puts upon them suspicion of the deed.
Against nature still, a thriftless ambition that would braven up thine own life's means? Then 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon me, Beth.
He's already named. I'm gone to Scone to be invested.
Where is Duncan's body?
Carried to Colmkill, the sacred storehouse of his predecessors and guardian of their bones.
Will you to Scone?
No, cousin, I'll fight.
Well, I will hither.
Well, may you see things well done there. Adieu. Lest our old robes sit easier than our new.
Farewell, lady.
The God's benison go with you, and with those that will make good or bad, and friends or foes.
Thou hast now king, cold, and bronze, all, as the weird women promised. I fear thou playest most foully for it. Yet it was said it should not stand in my posterity, but myself should be the root and father of many kings. If there come truth from them, as upon thee, Macbeth, their speeches shine, why, by the verities on thee, Ingrid, may they not be my oracle as well, and hold me up in hope. But hush, no more.
Here's our chief guest.
If he had been forgotten, it had been as a gap in our great feast, and all thing unbecoming.
Tonight we hold a solemn supper, sir, and I'll request your presence.
Let your highness command upon me, to which my duty is with a most indissoluble tie forever knit.
Ride you this afternoon?
Aye, my good lord.
We had else desired your good advice, which still hath been both grave and prosperous in this day's council.
But we'll take tomorrow.
Is it far you ride?
As far, my lord, as will fill up the time to this and supper. Go not my horse, the better I shall become a borrower of the night for a dark hour or twain.
Fail not our feast.
I shall not, my lord.
We hear our bloody cousin is bestowed in England, not confessing his cruel parricide, filling his hearers with strange adventures. But of that tomorrow, when therewithal we shall have cause of state craving us joint. Hire to horse, adieu, till you return at night. Goes Fleance with you?
Aye, my good lord, our time is called upon us.
I wish your horses swift and sure of foot, and so I do commend you to their backs. Farewell. Let everyone be master of her time till 7 at night. To make society the sweeter welcome, we will keep ourselves till supper time alone. Till then, God be with you. Arabella, a word with you. Attend those men our pleasure.
They are, my lord, without the palace gate.
Bring them before us. Thus is nothing. But to be safely thus, our fears in Banquo stick deep. And in his loyalty of nature reigns that which would be feared. 'Tis much he dares. And to that dauntless temper of his mind, he hath a wisdom that doth guide his vow to act in safety. There's none but he whom I do fear. And under him my genius is rebuked, as it is said, Mark Antony's was by Caesar. He chid the sisters when first they put the name of king upon me, and bade them speak to him. Then prophet-like, they hailed him father to a line of kings. Upon my head they placed a fruitless crown, and put a barren scepter in my grip, thence to be wretched within an unlineal line, no son of mine succeeding. Be so. For Banquo's issue have I fired my mind. For there, the gracious Duncan have I murdered. Put rancors in the vessels of my peace. Only for them and my eternal jewel, given to the common enemy of man, to make them kings. The seed of Banquo, kings. Rather than so, come fate into the list and champion me to the utterance. Who's there? Now go to the door and wait till we call. Was it not yesterday we spoke together?
It was, so please your highness.
Well then, now, have you considered of my speeches? Know that it was he, in the times past, which held you so under fortune, which you thought had been our innocent self. This I made good to you in our last conference. How we passed in probation together. How you were born and had, how crossed the instruments who wrought with them. And all things else, to half a soul and to a notion, pray say, thus in Banquo.
You made it known to us.
I did so, and went further, which is now our point of second meeting. Do you find your patience so predominant in your nature that you can let this go? Are you so gospeled to pray for this good man and his issue, whose heavy hand hath bowed you to the grave and beggared yours forever?
We are men, my liege.
In the catalogue ye go for me, as hounds and greyhounds, mongrels, spaniels, curs, choughs, water rugs, and demi-wolves are cleft all by the name of dogs. The valiant file distinguishes the swift, the slow, the son, the housekeeper, the hunter, and everyone according to the gifts which bounteous nature hath in enclosed, whereby he does receive particular addition to the bill that writes them all alike. And so of men. Now, if you have a station in the file, not in the worst rank of manhood, say it. And I will put that business in your bosom, whose execution will take your enemies off and grapple you to the heart and love of us who wear his health but sickly in his life, which in his death were perfect.
I am one, my liege, whom the vile blows and buffets of the world have so incensed I am reckless in what I do to spite the world.
And I another, so weary with disasters, tugged with fortunes, I would set my light on any chance to mend it or be rid of it.
Both of you know, Banquo was your enemy.
My lord.
So is he mine. And in such bloody distance that every minute of his being thrusts against my nearest of life. And though I could, with barefaced power, sweep him from my sight and bid my will about it, yet I must not, for certain friends, which are both his and mine, whose loves I may not drop. But wail his fall that I myself have struck down. Thence it is that I to your assistance do make love, masking the business from the common eye for sundry weighty reasons.
We shall, my lord, perform what you command us.
Though our lives may
your spirit shine through you. Within this hour at most, I will advise you where to plant yourselves, acquaint you with the perfect spy of the time, the moment on it. For it must be done tonight, and something from the palace. And with him, you leave no rods nor botches in the work. Flanks, the sun that keeps in company, whose absence is no less material to me than is his father's, must embrace the fate of that dark hour. Resolve yourselves apart. I'll come to you now. I've come to you straight. Abide with it. It is concluded. Banquo. Thy soul's flight, if it find heaven, must find it out tonight.
Is Banquo gone from the court?
Aye, madam, but returns again tonight.
Say to the king I would attend his leisure for a few words.
Madam, I will.
Not had, all spent, for our desire is got without content. But 'tis safer to be that which we destroy than by destruction dwell in doubtful joy. How now, my lord? Why do you keep alone? Of sorriest fancies your companions making, using those thoughts which should indeed have died with them they think on. Things without our remedy should be without regard. What's done is done.
We have scotched the snake, not killed it. She'll close and be herself, whilst our poor malice remains in danger of her former tooth. But let the frame of things disjoint, both the worlds suffer, ere we will eat our meals in fear, and sleep in the affliction of these terrible dreams that shake us nightly. Better be with the dead, whom we, to gain our peace, have set to peace, than on the torture of the mind to lie in restless ecstasy. Duncan is in his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst. Nor steel, nor poison, malice domestic, foreign money, nothing can touch him further.
Come on! Gentle, my lord. Sleep o'er your rugged looks. Be bright and jovial with your guests tonight.
So shall I, love. So I pray you, let your remembrance up
apply to bankroll, presenting evidence, both with eye and tongue, unsafe the while, that we must lave our honors in these flattering streams.
You must leave this.
Thou knowest that bankroll in his playouts lives.
But in them nature's copies, not etern.
There's comfort yet. They are assailed, then be thou jocund, ere the bat hath flown his cloistered flight, ere to black Hecate summons the shard-born beetle with his drowsy hums hath rung night's yawning peal. There shall be done a deed of dreadful note.
What's to be done?
Be innocent of the knowledge, dearest Chuck, till thou applaud the deed. Come, sealing night, scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, and with thy bloody and invisible hand, cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale. Light thickens, and the crow makes wing to the rooky wood. Good things of the day begin to droop and drowse, while night's black agents to their praise do rouse. Thou marvelst at my words. Hold thee still. Things bad begun make strong themselves by ill. So, really, go with me.
Join with us.
Macbeth?
He needs not our mistrust, since he delivers our offices and what we have to do. To the direction just.
Then stand with us. The west yet glimmers with some streaks of day, and now spurs the lady traveler apace to gain the timely air. Near approaches the subject of our watch.
Give a light there. Ho!
Hark, I hear a voice. A light. Stand to it.
It will be rain tonight.
Let it come down. Oh, first! Ah!
Away.
There's but one down. The sun has fled.
We have lost this half of our fire.
Well, let's away and say what has been done.
You know your own degrees. Sit down. I propose to last the hearty welcome.
Thanks, Your Majesty.
Ourself will mingle with society and play the humble host. Our hostess keeps her state, but in best time, we will request her welcome.
Pronounce it for me, sir, to all our friends, for my heart speaks, they are welcome.
See, they encountered into their hearts, thanks. But we are even on both sides. Here, I'll sit in the midst. Be large in mirth. Anon, we'll drink a measure of the Table Round. Dispatched?
My lord, his throat is cut. That I did for him.
Thou art the best of the cutthroats. Yet, it is good that did the like for Glance. Thou didst it. Thou art the non-throat.
Well, most royal sir, Flance escaped. Comes my fit again. I had else been perfect. Whole is the marble, bounded is the rock, as broad and general as a casing air. But now I am cabined, cribbed, confined, bound in by saucy doubts and fears. But Banquo is safe.
Aye, my good lord, safe in a ditch he bides, with 20 trenchant gashes on his head, the least of which a death to nature. Thanks for that.
There the grown serpent lies. The worm that's fled, that nature that's in time, then we'll breed. No teeth for the present. Get thee gone. Tomorrow, we'll hear ourselves again.
My royal lord, you do not give the cheer. The feast is sold that is not often vouched while 'tis a making. 'Tis given with welcome. The feed were best at home. From thence the sauce to meat is ceremony. Meeting were bare without it.
Sweet remembrance, sir. Now, good digestion, wait on health, and health on both.
May it please your highness, sit.
Here have you now our country's honor roofed with the grace person of our thankful present, whom may we challenge rather for unkindness than pity for mischance.
His absence, sir, lays blame upon his promise. Please it your highness to grace us with your royal company.
The table's full.
Here's a place reserved, sir.
Where?
Here, sir. What is it that moves your highness?
Which of you has done this?
What, my lord?
Thou canst not say I did! Never shake thy gory lock to me!
That was right, his highness is not well.
Sit, worthy friends. My lord is often thus. Have been from his youth. I pray you, keep seat. The fit is momentary. Upon thought, he will again be well. If much you note him, you shall offend him and extend his passion. Feed and regard him not. Are you a man?
Aye, and a bold one that dares look upon that which might appall the devil.
Proper stuff. This is the very painting of your fear. This is the air-drawn dagger which you said led you to Duncan. Oh, flaws and starts, impostors to true fear, would well become a woman's story at a winter's fire authorized by her grandam. Shame itself! Why do you make such faces? When all's done, you look but on a stool.
Really? See there? Behold, look! Lo! How say you? Why, what care I? If thou canst not speak to! If charnel houses in our graves must send those that we bury back, our graves would be, our monuments would be the moss of kites!
Quite unmanned in folly!
If I stand here, I'm sorry.
Fie for shame.
The time hath been that when the brains were out, the man would die, and there it is. But now they rise again with 20 golden murders on their crowns, and rise again.
My royal lord!
More strange than such a murder is.
Your noble friends do lack.
Oh,
Do not muse at me, my most worthy friends. I have a strange infirmity, which is nothing to those that know me. Come, love and health to all. Then I'll sit down. Give me some wine. Billful. I drink to the general joy of the whole table, and to our dear friend Benkor, whom we miss, would he were here. To all, and him we thirst, and all to all.
Our duties and the pledge.
Mark these with my sight! Let the air find thee! Thy blood is cold, thy bones are marrowless, and thou hast no speculation with those eyes which thou dost glare with.
Think of this, good Piers, whatever thing of custom. It is no other. Only it spoils the pleasure of the time.
I dare. Oh, that any man may dare. Approach thou like the rugged Russian bear, the upright ostrich, the scared tiger, take any shape but that, and my partner shall never trouble or be alive again, and dare me to the desert with thy knife. Oh, and it's horrible shadow! A real mockery, it's! Why so? Being gone, I am a man again. Pray you sit still.
You have displaced the mirth, broke the good meeting with most admired disorder.
Can such things be? And overcome us like a summer's cloud. You make me strange, even to my true disposition. When now I think that you can behold some sights and keep the natural ruby in thy cheeks, when mine is blessed with fear.
What sights, my lord? I pray you speak not. He grows worse and worse. Question enrages him. At once, good night. Stand not upon the order of your going, but go at once.
Good night, no. And better help attend his majesty.
A kind good night to all.
It will have blood, they say. Blood will have blood. Stones have been known to move and trees to speak. Augurs and understood relations have by magpies and by chops and rooks brought forth the secret as man and blood. What is the night?
Almost at odds with morning, which is which.
How sayest thou? Macduff denies his person at our great bidding.
Did you send to him, sir?
I hear it by the way, but I will send. There's not one of them, but in his house I keep a servant feed. I will tomorrow, and times I will to the weird sisters, more shall they speak. And now, I am bound to know by the worst means, the worst, for mine own good, all causes shall give way. I am in blood, stepped in so far that, should I wade no more, returning would be as tedious as no more. Strange things I have in head, that will to hand, must be acted ere they may be scanned.
You lack the season of all natures. Flee.
Come. Will to sleep. My strange and ill use. fear that wants hard use. We are yet but young indeed.
My former speeches have but hit your thoughts, which can interpret forever. Only I say, things have been strangely born. But the gracious Duncan was pitied of Macbeth. Mary, he was dead. And the right valiant Banquo walked too late, whom, you may say, if it please you, Fleance killed. For Fleance fled. Who cannot want the thought how monstrous it was for Malcolm and for Donalbane to kill their gracious father? Damned father. How it did grieve Macbeth. Did he not straight in pious rage to delinquents tear that were the slaves of drink and thralls of sleep? Was that not nobly done? Aye, and wisely too, for 'twould have angered any heart alive to hear the man deny it. So what I say, he's borne all things well. And I do think that had he Duncan's sons under his key, as, and please God, heaven he shall not, they should find what 'twere to kill a father. So should Fleance. But peace, for from broad cause and words he felt his presence at the tyrant's feast, I hear him doth lips in disgrace. Can you tell where he bestows himself? The son of Duncan, from whom this tyrant holds the due of birth, lives in the English court, and is received of the most pious Edward with such grace that the malevolence of fortune nothing takes from his high respect. Thither Macduff has gone to pray the holy king upon his aid to wake Northumberland and warlike Seward. That, by the help of these, with him above, to ratify the work, we may again give to our tables meat, sleep to our nights, free from our feasts and banquets bloody knives, do faithful homage, and receive free honors, all which we pine for now. And this report hath so exasperate the king that he prepares for some attempt of war. Sent to him himself? He did, and with an absolute sir, not I. The clapping messenger turns his back and hums, as who should say, rue the time that clogs me with this answer. And well that might advise him to a caution, to hold what distance his wisdom can provide. Some holy angel fly to the court of England, and unfold his message ere he come. That a swift blessing may soon return to this our suffering country under hand accursed. I'll send my prayers with him.
find the worm. Sing! Bird's leg! An owlet's wing!
Or a charm of powerful trouble! Like a hell broth, vile and bubble! Double, double, toil and trouble! Fire burn in a cauldron bubble!
Scale of dragon!
Tooth of wolf! Oh.
Witch's money! Digged in the dark. Liver of blaspheming shrew. Gall of goat. And slips of yew slivered in the moon's eclipse. Nose of Turk and tartar's lips. Finger of bird strangled babe. Delivered by a drab.
Against the churches, though the yusty waves confound and swallow navigation up, though bladed corn be lodged and trees blown down, though castles topple on their warders' heads, though palaces and pyramids do slump their heads to their foundations, though the treasure of nature's germens tumble all together, even till destruction sickens. Answer me to what I ask you.
Speak.
Demand.
We'll answer. Say, if thou'dst rather hear it from our mouths or from our masters.
Call. Let me see.
Pour in sow's blood that hath eaten her nine pharaoh. Grease that's sweating from the murderer's gibbet. Throw into the flame. Come on.
There thou art, for thy good conscience thanks. Thou hast harked my fear aright, but one word more.
It will not be commanded. Here's another, more potent than the first.
Macbeth, Macbeth, Macbeth.
Had I 3 years, I'd hear thee.
Be bloody, bold, and resolute. Laugh to
scorn the power of man, for none of woman born shall harm Macbeth.
And live, Macduff, what need I fear of thee? But yet I'll make assurance double sure, and take a bond of fate. Thou shalt not live, that I may tell pale-hearted fear it lies, and sleep in spite of thunder. What is this that rises like the issue of a king? Wears upon his baby brow the run and top of sovereignty.
Listen, but speak not till it!
Be lying metal, proud, and show no care. Who chase, who frets, or where conspires are. Macbeth shall never vanquished be, until great Burnham Wood to high Dunsinane Hill shall come against him.
That shall never be! Who can impress the forest, beat the tree, unfix his earthbound root? Sweet bodements good. Rebellious dead rise never till the wood of Burnham rise, and our high place Macbeth shall live a lease of nature, pay his breath to time and mortal custom. But my heart throbs to know one thing. Tell me if thy art can tell so much. Shall Banquo's issue ever reign in this kingdom?
Seek to know no more!
I will be satisfied! Deny me this, and an eternal curse fall on you! Spirit of Banquo, down! Thy crown doth sear mine eyeballs. And thy hair, thou other gold-bound brow, is like the first. The third is like the former. Filthy hack! Why do you show me this? Another, fourth. What will the line stretch out to crack your doom? Another yet the seventh. I am look no more! And yet today, disappear, bearing a glass, showing me many more. And some I see, the twofold ball and treble scepter carry. Horrible sight! Now I see, tis true, for the blood bowl to Banquo smiles upon me and points at their face. What? Is this so? Is this so?
Aye, sir. All this is so. But why stands Macbeth thus amazedly? Come, sisters, cheer we up his sprites and show the best of our delights. I'll charm here to give a sound while you perform your antic round.
Weird sisters?
No, my lord.
Came they not by you?
No, indeed, my lord.
Affected be the air whereon they ride. And damned be all that trust them! and I swear I heard a word or two who wasn't came by.
'Tis two, or three, my lord, that bring you word. Macduff has fled to England.
Fled to England?
Aye, my good lord.
Time now anticipates my dread exploits. Flighty purposes never o'ertook unless the deed go with it. From this moment, the very firstlings of my heart shall be the firstlings of my hand. And even now, to crown my thoughts with that, be it thought and done. The castle of Macduff will I surprise. Seize upon fire. Get to the edge of the sword, his wife, his babes, and all unfortunate souls that trace him in his line. No more boasting like a fool. This deed I'll do before this purpose cool. No more sights. Where are these gentlemen? Come, bring me where they are.
What has he done to make him fly the land?
You must have patience, madam.
He had none. His flame is madness. When our actions do not, our fears do make us traitors.
You know not whether it was his wisdom or his fear.
Wisdom? To leave his wife? To leave his babes? To leave his mansion and his titles in a place from whence himself does fly? He loves us not. He wants the natural touch. For the poor wren, the most diminutive of birds, will fight her young ones in her nest against the owl. All is the fear and nothing is the love. As little as the wisdom, when the flight so runs against all reason.
My dearest Kaz, I pray you school yourself. But for your husband, he is noble, wise, judicious, and best knows the fits of the season. I dare not speak much further. What cruel are the times when we are traitors and do not know ourselves, when we hold rumor from what we fear, yet know not what we fear, but float upon a wild and violent sea, each way and none. I take my leave of you. You shall not be long till I'll be here again. Things at the worst will cease, or else climb up with you what they were before. My pretty cousin, blessing upon you.
Fathers, he is, and yet he's fatherless.
I am so much a fool. Should I stay longer, it would be my disgrace and your discomfort. I take my leave at once.
And what will you do now? How will you live?
Birds do, mother.
What? With worms and flies?
With what I get, I need, and so do they.
Oh, poor bird. Thou next never fear the net nor line, the pitfall nor the snare.
Why should I, mother? Poor birds, they are not set for. My father is not dead for all your sake.
Yes, he is dead. How wilt thou do for a father?
Nay, how wilt thou do for a husband?
Why, I can buy me 20 at any market.
Then you'll buy and sell again.
Thou speak'st with all thy wits, and yet in faith, with wits enough for thee.
Was my father a traitor, mother?
Aye, that he was.
Was a traitor?
Why, one that swears and lies.
And be all traitors that do so?
Everyone that does so is a traitor and must be hanged.
Who must hang them?
Why, the honest men.
Then the liars and swears are fools, for there are liars and swears enough to beat the honest men and hang up them.
Oh, no. God help thee, poor monkey. But how is that to for a father?
If you were dead, you'd weep for him. If you were not, it were a good sign that I should quickly have a new father.
Oh, poor bachelor. How thou talkst.
Bless you, fair lady. I am not you known, but in your state of honor I am perfect. I fear some danger doth approach you nearly. If you will take an old woman's advice, be not found here. Hence with your little ones. To fright you thus, methinks I am too savage. To do worse to you, a fell cruelty, which is too nigh your person. Heaven protect you. I dare abide no longer.
Whither should I fly? I have done no harm. Yet, I remember now. I am in this earthly world where to do harm is often laudable. To do good sometimes a kind of dangerous folly. Why then, alas, do I put up that womanly defense and say, I have done no harm? What are these faces?
Where is your husband?
I hope in no case so unsanctified or such as thou mayst find him.
He's a traitor.
Thou light, thou shattered villain.
What? You egg. Young fry, treachery.
You killed me, mother. Run away. Pray you.
Desolate shade, and there weep our sad bosoms empty.
Let us rather hold fast the mortal sword, and like good men bestride our downfallen birthday.
Each new morn, new widows howl, new orphans cry, new sorrows strike heaven in the face that it resounds as if it felt with Scotland. Yelled out like syllable of joy. What I believe all well, what no believe in. When I can redress it, I shall find the time to friend, I will. What you have spoke, it may be so, perchance. This tyrant, whose sole name blisters our tongue, was once thought honest. You loved him well. He hath not touched you yet.
I am not treacherous.
But Macbeth is. That which you are, my thoughts cannot transpose. Though all things foul would wear the brows of grace, yet grace must still look so.
I have lost my hopes.
Perchance even there where I did find my doubts. Why? In that rawness left you wife and child. Those prejudicious motives, those strong knots of love, without leave-taking. You may be rightly just, whatever I shall think.
Bleed, poor country. Great tyranny laid all thy bases sure, but goodness dare not check thee.
Fare thee well, lord.
I would not be the villain thou thinkst for the whole kingdom in the tyrant's grasp, and the rich east to boot.
Be not offended. I speak not as an absolute out of you. I think our country sinks beneath the yoke. It weeps, it bleeds, and each new day a gash is added to her wounds. I think withal there would be hands uplifted in my right. And here, from gracious England, have I offered goodly thousands. But for all this, when I shall tread upon the tyrant's head or wear it on my sword, yet my poor country will have more vices than it had before, more suffer in more sundry ways than ever by him that shall succeed.
What should he be?
It is myself, I mean, in whom I know all the particulars of vice so grafted that when they shall be open, Black Macbeth will seem as pure as snow, and the poor stay esteem him as a lamb being compared with my confinedest harms.
Not in the legions of horrid hell could come a devil more damned in evils to top Macbeth.
I grant him bloody, luxurious, avaricious, false, deceitful, sudden, malicious, smacking of every sin that has a name. But there is no bottom, none, in my voluptuousness. Your wives, your daughters, your matrons and your maids could not fill up the cistern of my lust. And my desire?
All restraining impediments would o'erbear that did oppose my will. Better Macbeth than such an one to reign.
Boundless intemperance in nature is a tyranny. But fear not yet to take upon you what is yours. We have willing dames enough. There cannot be that vulture in you to devour so many as will to greatness dedicate themselves, finding it so inclined.
And yet there is, in my most ill-composed affection, such an avarice that were I king, I should cut off the nobles for their lands, desire his jewels in others' house, and my more having would be a sauce to make me hunger more, that I should forge quarrels unjust with the good and loyal, destroying them for wealth.
This avarice sticks deeper, grows with more pernicious root than summer seeming lust. But do not fear. All these are bearable with other graces. Wait.
But I have none. The king becoming graces is justice, verity, temperance, stableness, vanity, perseverance,
mercy,
loveliness, devotion, patience, courage, fortitude. I take no relish in any of them, but found the variety of each several crime, acting it in many ways. Nay, had I power, I would pour the sweet milk of Concord into hell, uproar the universal peace, confound all unity on earth.
Scotland, Scotland.
If such a one be fit to govern, speak. I have as I have spoken.
Fit to govern? No, not to live. Oh, nation miserable with an untitled tyrant, bloody scepter. When shalt thou see thy wholesome days again? Since the fairest issue of thy throne, by his own interdiction, stands accursed and does blaspheme his breed. My father was a most sainted king, a mother, queen, that bore thee. Oftener upon her knees than on her feet. Die every day she lived. Fare thee well. These evils thou repeatest upon thyself have banished me from Scotland. Oh, my rest. My hope ends here.
Macduff, this noble passion, child of integrity, hath from my soul wiped the black scruples, reconciled my thoughts to thy good truth and honor. Devilish Macbeth, by many of these tricks, hath sought to win me into his power. But God above deal between thee and me. For even now I put myself to thy direction, and speak mine own detraction, hear abjure the taints and blames I laid upon myself, for strangers to my nature. I am yet unknown to woman, never was forsworn. Scarcely have coveted what was mine own, at no time broke my faith. Would not betray the devil to his fellow, and delight no less in truth than in life. What I am truly is thine and my poor country's to command. Whither indeed, before thy here approach, old Seward, with 10,000 warlike men, already at the point, was setting forth. Now, let us together, and the chance of goodness be like our warranted quarrel. Why are you silent?
Such welcome and unwelcome things at once. It's hard to reconcile. See who comes here. My ever gentle cousin, welcome hither. Stand Scotland where it did.
Alas, poor country, almost afraid to know itself. It cannot be called our mother, but our grave, where violent sorrow seems a modern ecstasy. The dead man's knell is there scarce asked for who, and good men's lives expire before the flowers in their caps, dying or ere they sicken.
What's the newest grief?
Each minute teems a new one.
How does my wife?
Why, well.
And all my children?
Well, too.
The tyrant have not battered at their peace.
No, they were well at peace when I did leave them.
Be not a miser of your speech. How goes it?
When I came hither to transport the tidings which I have heavily borne, there ran a rumor of many worthy fellows that were up in arms. Your eye in Scotland would create soldiers, make our women fight to doff their dire distresses.
Be at their comfort, we are coming thither. Gracious England hath lent us good soup and 10,000 men. An older and a better soldier, none that Christendom gives out.
Would I could answer this comfort you like. But I have words that would be held out in the desert air where hearing should not latch them.
What concern they? The general cause? Or some single breast?
No mind that's honest, but in it shares some woe, though the main part pertains to you alone.
It be mine. Keep it not from me. Quickly, let me have it.
Let not your ears despise my tongue forever, which shall possess them with the heaviest sound that ever yet they knew.
Oh, I guess that is.
Your castle is surprised. Your wife and babes savagely slaughtered. To relate the manner were on the quarry of these murdered deer to add the death of you.
What, man? Merciful heaven, give sorrow words! The grief that does not speak bids the orphan heart and bids it break.
Wife, children, servants, all that could be found.
That must be from thence.
My wife killed too.
I have said.
Be comforted. Let's make us medicines of our great revenge. Cure this deadly grief.
He has no children.
All my pretty ones. Did you say all?
Oh, hell tide!
All! Oh, what? All my pretty chickens in their dam at one fell swoop!
Dispute it like a man!
Also feel it as a man. I cannot but remember such things were that were most precious to me. Did heaven look hard and would not take their part?
Sinful Macduff, you were all struck with thee.
Not that I am, not for their own demerits, but for mine. They'll slaughter on their souls.
This the whetstone to thy sword. Let grief convert to anger. Blunt not the heart and rage it.
Oh, I could play the woman with mine eyes and the braggart with my tongue. But gentle heavens, cut short all intermission. Front to front, bring thou this fiend of Scotland and myself. Within my blade's length, set him. If he scape, heaven forgive him too.
This tune grows manly. Come, go we to the king. Our power is ready. Our lack is nothing but our leave. Macbeth is ripe for shaking, and the powers above put on their instruments. To see what cheer you may. The night is long, but never finds the day.
Two nights watch with you, but can perceive no truth in your report. When was it that she last walked?
Since his majesty first went into the field, I have seen her rise from her bed, throw upon herself her nightgown, unlock her closet, take forth paper, fold it, write upon it, read it, afterwards seal it, return it to her closet, and return it to her bed, all the while in the most fast sleep.
Great perturbation in nature to receive at once the benefit of sleep and do the effect of watching. slumbering agitation, besides her walking and other actual performances, what at any time have you heard her say?
That, sir, which I will not report after her.
You may to me, it is most me you should.
No, but you or to anyone, since I have no witness to confirm my report. Amoyo, here she comes. This is her very guise, and upon my word, fast asleep. Observe her, you are close.
You see her eyes are open.
Aye, but their sense is shut.
She does now. Look how she rubs her hands.
This is an accustomed action of her, to see us washing her hands. I have seen her continue in this quarter of an hour.
Yet there's a spot.
Hark, she speaks. I will set down what comes from her to satisfy my remembrance the more strongly. Go to. You have known what you should not.
She has spoken what she should not, I am sure of that. Heaven knows what she has known.
It's the smell of blood still!
All the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand.
Sorely charged.
I would not have such a heart in my bosom for the dignity of the whole body.
Well.
Pray God it be, sir.
This disease is beyond my practice. Yet I have known those which have walked in their sleep who have died holily in their beds.
Wash your hands. Put on your nightgown. Look not so pale. I tell you yet again, Banquo's buried! He cannot come out of his grave!
Oh, indeed so.
To bed. There's a knocking at the gate. Come, give me your hand! What's done cannot be undone.
Will she go now to bed?
Directly.
Now whisper. Natural days do breed unnatural troubles. Infected minds, their deaf pillows, will discharge their secrets. More needs she the divine than the physician. God forgive us all. Look after her. Remove from her all the means of annoyance, and still keep eyes upon her. So good night. Mine eyes she has perplexed and amazed my sight. I think, but I cannot speak.
Good night, good doctor.
The English power is near, led on by Malcolm, his uncle Stuart, and the good Macduff. Revenges burns in them for their dear cause, which to the bleeding and the grim alarm excite the mortified man.
Near Burnham Wood shall we well meet them. That way are they coming.
I have a file of all the gentry. There is Seward's son and many unruff youths that even now protest their first of manhood.
What does the tyrant? Great Dunsinane, he strongly fortifies. Some say he's mad. Others that lesser hate him do call it valiant fury. But for certain, he cannot buckle his distempered cause within the belt of rule.
Now does he feel his secret murder sticking on his hands. Now minutely revolts upbraid his meek breach.
Those he commands move only in command, nothing in love.
Now does he feel his title hang loose about him, like a giant's robe upon a dwarfish thief.
Who then can blame his pestered senses to recoil and start, when all that is within him must condemn itself for being there?
Well, march we on, to give obedience where 'tis truly owed. Meet we the medicine of the sickly wheel, and with him pour we in our country's purge each drop of us.
Or so much as it needs to dew the sovereign flower and drown the weeds. Make we our march towards Burnham.
Huzzah! Bring me no more reports! Let them fly off! Till Burnham Wood become the Dunsinane, I cannot taint with fear. What, the boy Malcolm, was he not born of woman? The spirits that know all mortal consequences have pronounced me thus.
Fear not, Macbeth. No man born of woman shall e'er have power upon thee.
Then fly, false thanes, and mingle with the English epicures. The mind I sway by and the heart I bear shall never sag with doubt, nor shake with fear.
The devil damn thee, black thou cream-faced loon! Where got thou that gibbous lurk?
There is 10,000...
geese, villain!
Soldiers, sir!
Girl, prick thy face and overread thy fear, thou lily-livered boy! What soldier's patch? Death of thy soul! Those linen cheeks of thine are counselors to fear. What soldiers, we face?
The English force, so please you.
Take thy face hence. Satan, I'm sick at heart when I behold... Satan, I say! This push... cheer me ever, or deceit me now. I have lived long enough. My way of life has fallen into the sear, the yellow leaf, and that which should accompany old age is honor, love, obedience, troops of friends. I must not look to have, but in their stead, curses. Not loud, but deep. Mouth honor, breath, which the poor heart would fain deny and dare not. Satan!
What is your gracious pleasure?
What's news more?
All is confirmed, my lord, which has been reported.
I'll fight till from my bones my flesh be hacked. Give me mine armor.
'Tis not needed yet.
I'll put it on. Send out more horses. Scour the country round. Hang on that talk of fear! Get me my armor! Doctor, how does thy patient?
Not so sick, my lord, as she is troubled with thick coming fancies that disturb her rest.
Cure her in that. Canst thou not minister to a mind disease? Pluck from the memory, a rooted sorrow. Raise out the written troubles of the brain, and with some sweet, oblivious antidote, cleanse that stuffed breast of that perilous stuff which weighs upon the heart.
Therein the patient must minister to himself.
Go visit to the dark, I'll manage it! Come, put on my arm! Come on! Get me my belt! Satan, send out! Doctor, the fiends fly from me! Come, sir, dispatch! If thou couldst, doctor, cast the water of my land, find its disease, purge it to a firm and pristine health. Take off. I would applaud thee to the very echo. That would applaud thee again. What rhubarb, a senna, or what permanent drug can scour the English heads? Hearst thou of them?
Aye, my good lord, your royal preparation makes us hear something.
But laugh at me. I will not be afraid of death and bane. Till Burnham Forest come to Dunsinane.
Were I from Dunsinane, away and clear. Prophet again should hardly draw me here.
Cousins, I hope the days are near at hand. Chambers will be safe.
Doubt it's nothing.
What is this before us?
What bird?
Let each soldier come down and bow and bear before him. Thereby shall we shadow the numbers of our host to make discovery ere and report us.
Shall be done.
We learn, however, that the confident tyrant keeps still in Dunsinane, and will endure our setting down before it. The time approaches that will, with due decision, make us know what we shall say we have and what we owe. Thoughts speculative, their unsure hopes relate. Certain issue, strokes must arbitrate, toward which the war!
Hang on, John, brother, to me up with walls. The cry is still their comfort. Our castle's strength will laugh the siege to scorn. Here let them lie till famine and the ague eat them up. Were they not joined with some that should be ours, we might have met them dare, beard to beard, beat them backward home.
What is that noise? It's the cry of women.
I have almost forgot the taste of fears. Time has been. My senses would have cooled to hear a night shriek, and my fell of hair without a dismal treatise rouse and stir as life were in it. I am full sought with horrors. Dionysus, familiar with my slaughterous thoughts, cannot once stop me. Wherefore was that cry?
The queen, my lord, is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been time for such a word. Tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lighted fruits, the way to dusty death. Out. Out. Grief candle. Life is but a walking shadow. A poor player who struts and frets his hour upon the stage, and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot. Full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
Case, to use thy tongue, thy story quickly.
Gracious my lord, I should report that which I say I saw, but know not how to say it.
Say!
As I did stand my watch upon the hill, I looked toward Burnham, and anon methought, the wood began to move.
Liar, and say it!
Let me endure your wrath if it be not so. Within this 3 miles, you may see it coming. I say, a moving grove.
If thou speak'st false, upon the next tree shalt thou hang alive till famine cling thee. If thy speech be sooth, I care not if thou dost for me as much. I pull in resolution and begin to doubt the equivocation of the fiend that lies like truth.
Fear not, till Burnham Wood do come to Dunsinane.
And now a wood comes toward Dunsinane. Arm and out, if this which she about just does appear. There is no flying hence or tarrying here. I begin to be weary of the sun, and wish the estate of the world were now undone. Ring the alarm bell! Blow wind! Come rack! At least we die with harness on our back!
Not near enough. Your leafy screens throw down, as sure like those you are. You were the uncle, so was my cousin, your right noble son, lead our first battle. Macduff and we shall take upon us what else remains to do according to our order.
Very well. Do we but meet the tyrant's power tonight? Let us be beaten if we cannot fight, and all our trumpets speak. Give them all breath, those clamorous harbingers of blood and death!
They have tied me to a stake. I cannot fly, but bear like I must fight the course. But he that was not born of woman, such a one I am to fear, or not.
What is thy name?
Thou be afraid to hear it.
No, though thou callest thyself a name harder than any is in hell.
My name's Macbeth.
The devil himself did not pronounce a tale more hateful to my ear.
No, nor more fearful.
You pious and poor tyrant, with my weapon I'll prove the lie you speak.
Thou was born of woman! Knives I smile at, weapons laugh to scorn, brandished by one of woman born.
That way the noise is. Iron, show thy face. If thou be slain with no stroke of mine, wife and children's ghosts will haunt me still. That sprite of wretched curds whose arms are higher to bear their stays, the thou, Macbeth, or else my blade with an unbattered edge I sheathe again undeeded. Here thou shouldst be. By this great clatter, one of greatest note seems bruited. Let me find him fortune. More I bear not.
Gently rendered, the tyrant's people on both sides who fight, the noble thanes fight bravely in the war, the day almost itself professes yours, and little is to do.
We have met with the foes that strike beside us.
Enter, sir, the castle.
Why should I play the Roman fool and die on my own sword? While I see lives, the ashes do better upon them.
Turn, hellhound.
heard. Of all men else, I have avoided thee. But get thee back! My soul is too much charged with blood of thine already.
I have no words. My blood voices in my blade, the bloodier villain.
Get me out!
Keen blade impresses me deeply. Let fall thy blade on vulnerable crests. I bear a charmed life and must not yield to one of woman born.
Despair thy charm, and let the angel whom thou still hast served tell thee Macduff was from his mother's womb untimely ripped.
First, the tongue that tells me so, for it hath counted my better part of man. And be these juggling fiends no more believed, that palter with us in a double sense, that keep the word of promise to our ear and break it to our hope. I'll not fight with thee.
Then yield ye, coward, and live to be the gaze and show of the time. We'll have thee as our redder monsters are. Pay down on our pool, and on your red here may you see the tyrant.
I will not yield to kiss the ground before young Malcolm's feet, and to be baited with the rabble's curse. Though Burnham Wood be come to Dunsinane, and thou oppose it, being of no woman born, yet I will try the last. Before my body I throw my warlike shield. Lay on Macduff, and damn be him that first cries, "Oh, enough!"
Where the friends we missed were safe arrived.
Some must go off.
And yet, by these I see, so great a day as this is cheaply bought.
Macduff, as you see, and your worthy son.
Your son, my lord, has paid a soldier's debt. He only lived but till he was a man, for which no sooner had his prowess confirmed in the unshrinking station where he fought, but like a man who died.
Then he is dead?
Aye. Your cause of sorrow must not be measured by his worth, for then it hath no end.
Had he his hurts before?
Aye, on the front.
Why then, God's soldier be he, that I as many sons as I have hairs, I could not wish him to a fairer death. And so, his knell is no.
He's worth more sorrow, and that I'll spend on him.
He's worth no more. They say he parted well and paid his score. So God be with him. Here comes newer comfort.
Hail, King. So thou art. The tyrant is free! I see thee compassed with thy kingdom's pearl, who speak my salutation in their minds, whose voices I desire aloud with mine. Hail, King of Scotland!
Hail, King of Scotland!
We shall not be long before we reckon with your several loves and make us even with you. My thanes and kinsmen, henceforth be earls, the first that ever Scotland in such an honor named. what's more to do, which would be planted newly with the time, as calling home our exiled friends abroad that fled the snares of watchful tyranny, producing forth these cruel ministers of this dead butcher and this fiend-like queen, who, as 'tis thought, by self and violent hands took off her life. This, and what needful else we are called upon to do, by the grace of grace, we will perform in measure, time, and place. So, thanks to all at once, and to each one, whom we invite to see us crowned at Scone.